Say yes to new beginnings.
Yes.
Say yes to new standards of excellence.
Yes.
Say yes to engaging reportage with a difference.
Yes.
Introducing Yes International Magazine. The time to say yes to your dreams and aspirations is here.
Our guest tonight is Hilda Dokubo. Hilda Dokubo is an actress. She's also a producer. And of late or recently, she's become an activist. Before all those months, she was, she was a former special advisor on youth affairs to ex-Governor Peter Dele of River State. She was born on October 22, 1967, and that makes her 53 years old. Even though she's still looking 18.
I think you are incorrect. You are incorrect about my date of birth.
Okay.
I never said it on live TV. I'm 22nd of October 1969. Please.
69, all right.
Please stay corrected, because.
All right. Thank you very much. Now, you also have to do something about it, because you still have 1967 on your Wikipedia. So you need to change that. The earlier you do that, the better. Because whoever is trying to do something on you usually refers to that. So you have to find a way to get that rectified.
Okay. All right. Yeah. I don't know who did that, but I'll tell them to do it. Thank you.
All right. So that makes her 51 years old. She's from Buguma in River State. She attended St. Mary's State School in Port Harcourt. She was also at Government Girls Secondary School, equally in Port Harcourt, and finally the University of Port Harcourt, where she bagged her first and master's degree in theatre arts. Among her popular works are Evil Passion. She actually started with that. Then there's Stigma, The CEO, End of the Wicked, Gone Forever, Forever, Fatal Desire, Jezebel, etc., etc. So tonight, she'll be sharing her Nollywood story with us. So once again, you're welcome.
Thank you very much, Azu. I don't have a Nollywood.
We'll see how it goes. We'll see how it goes. Okay. All right. Yes, I want to take the first question. Are you ready?
Yes, let's go.
All right. Now, what inspired your choice of studying theater arts at the University of Port Harcourt?
I must confess, it just came naturally, right? I started acting as a kid, as a child performer, first on radio, then on stage, then on television, and then on film. And all through, from childhood and all of that, I didn't know what I was going to become. I was just doing what childhood restlessness threw my way, and thank God I was encouraged by a good father. So by the time I was ready for the university, my mom was ready to have me become a lawyer. My dad had passed on, but before he passed on, he was open to anything that I chose. And to fulfill my mother, I wanted to be a lawyer, but it was also at a time when there was a lot of crisis, just like now, in northern Nigeria. And my first choice was ABU Zaria, because I wanted to go very far from home. I'd spent the whole time at home, and I wanted to go very far. But, faith kept me in River State. And Port Harcourt was not my first choice, was not second choice, was not third choice, was not in the list of choice, but I was at a point where it was now important to come back home. And coming back home, in fact, I came in a day to the close of registration. One day to the close of registration. Wow. I signed up. I went in to do the diploma, blah, blah, blah. The rest of it is history. So what informed it was just the fact that I had started doing that from childhood, and it was now natural. So, yeah, I didn't know where it was going, but it was going somewhere anyways.
All right. Now, would you say that acting has provided for you everything you ever wanted from it? Has acting provided everything you ever wanted from it?
It has, and even more. It has provided Bad Belle, and also and also provided people certain standards for you. It has also provided people wanting to, you know, decide, cut a standard for you, tell you what you should or shouldn't do. So a whole lot that acting has done. But most importantly, it has also earned a lot of love, a whole lot of love. People love you, people respect you, people think that they owe you something special. Some of them know what they owe you, some don't know what they owe you. People feel like you live in their home. It makes you an influencer. You influence a lot of things, the way people think, the way they talk, the way they dress. So, you know, it has provided a lot, good and bad, but it has also created a balance. It gives you an opportunity to stay permanently humble, because you are not who you are because you are the best of everything. You are who you are because of grace and because people chose to love you. Nothing extra.
Wow, interesting. Interesting. Now, what was drama school like back then?
I have not seen work like it, Azul. Drama school used to be strenuous, tedious. Hey, but hectic. Jesus Christ, you don't even want to know. You wake up early in the morning, let's say like 5 o'clock, 6:30, you are in the theater for movement and drill. Okay, what people used to call jumpology those days. Because all we did was beat the drum and do physical exercises, voice exercises, forming shapes with our bodies and all of that. That was what we did. And everyone, you know, other people in school didn't understand how another group of students will play the whole time. Play the whole time in school. But we were not playing. We were working, because the tool of the actor is his body. And we were constantly working on that body and voice. So it was a real tedious time. But it was also a friendship building time. Because most of the friends I have up until this day, I met and made during those years in school.
Wow. Wow, interesting. Interesting. Now, you've been acting for decades now. What would you say has kept you going?
Humility and integrity. Azu, you know me. You are my friend. If I give you my word, I stand by it. I'm a highly disciplined person and highly self-assessing all the time. I am my own evaluator first. I fail myself or pass myself before anyone else does that for me. I am critical about what I do. So those are the things that has kept me. And I believe in relationships. I believe in building, maintaining, servicing, and keeping relationships. No matter what you do to me, as you know me, I blow hot immediately. My anger is effervescent. I will go, whoa! 2 minutes later, ask me what has happened. I have forgotten. I don't even remember we had it. I had to shout at, you know, like 2 minutes earlier. That is what has kept me going. Discipline and deep-seated love in my heart for other people and for my craft. Those are it. Nothing extra.
Wow. Now, for anybody to have a taste of success as an actor, what must the person do?
What you must do is train and drop dead training. Because you can't stop feeling yourself. As an actor, you're constantly exploring you. You are constantly going inside of you, doing emotional recalls, living in the moment, building lives that you take on. So you can never say, I am good as an actor. You must constantly train and refill yourself. You must identify people who are good at what they do and see why they are good. Do not feel embarrassed to ask for help. Do not feel embarrassed to train and retrain yourself. Do not feel embarrassed to go wrong. And please, when you go wrong, admit it, correct it, and move on. As an actor, if you want to stay fresh, you're as good as your last work, you're good as the relationships that you built. And I'm not talking about couch relationships. Hello? Don't even think about it. If you sleep with one person to get a role, auntie, you will sleep until there will be no mattress anymore. There will be no mattress, there will be no mat. Because people are going to keep passing one, you know, from one mattress to another mattress, and your whole back will peel off. So don't even go there. That's not where to go. Stay on the path of reinventing yourself constantly. As you said something, you have refused to age. I have not refused to age. I am aging. I'm constantly reinventing me. Constantly. I'm finding a new part of me that needs to be explored. And I explore it. I explore those new bits of me. And that's it. Please don't go outside those. Don't go outside doing your work professionally with discipline and with love for your craft. Please.
Wow. Interesting. Now, I need you to share with us your most memorable acting experience.
Okay. there are lots of them. So I'm going to just take them gradually. One is Goodbye Tomorrow. And Goodbye Tomorrow was because it happened at a time when people hardly knew anything about HIV/AIDS. And I saw a very beautiful script. To be able to play that role, I had to, every single day of my life, go to the life support center at Ikeja. Then I was young, fresh from school, right? My home was in Ago Palace Way. Life support center. Yeah, life support center is in Ikeja. Zen's office is Surulere. But I had to go to those three ends just to be able to play this role. I had to lose weight from a size 14 to a size 8 just to play that role. It took a lot of work off me. A lot of work. That's one. The second one was Forever by Amaka Igwe. May her gentle soul rest. Amaka handed me this script. I had a reading audition with three amazing actresses, and I mean amazing. Two of whom I respect with everything inside of me, because when they started acting, I was just sitting acting. So if they had told me I didn't pass that audition, I for now vex, because the two other people, there were three, two of them, you know when you know that these are babalas in this thing. Yeah. You are there, you are humble, and you are saying, I guess I got that role because I was able to play with my accent to sound really purely native. And maybe that was what she was also looking for. And then we had this particular scene in Forever. I can never forget. When Efelepe's child was taken away from her with yam and rice, I broke down and cried. At the time, I was a single mom, and I couldn't imagine how anybody from anywhere would come and take my child with yam and rice. I cried so much, and it stayed there, and everybody, including the cameraman, everybody broke down. The third one was when I was directing another Campus Tale, because first, I think the truth is, you know, I invest a lot of energy in interpretation. I invest a lot of energy in building the characters that I leave for the period of shoot after which I undress. You know, just the same way I remove my costumes, I remove that character refresh, which is why I don't do two jobs at a time. So there are lots and lots of memorable moments, but let's deal with this four.
Yeah, interesting. Now, what makes a good actress?
What makes a good actor? Ability to create and recreate. Ability to be extraordinary. Nobody wants to watch a performance of an ordinary person. When you hear a story, the story you want to listen to is a simple story with extraordinary twists. Your ability to your ability to be spontaneous, to be alive, to be truthful and real. You know, every actor, you need that. You need to be able to play that character truthfully and convincingly. Because if you are not convinced, how do you convince the people at home? How do you do that? So that is going to be really tough. So for me, what makes you a fantastic actor is your ability to trust you and to trust the other people. So you build that. Your ability to come on with something extra of the ordinary, to come spontaneous, okay? To be expressive of yourself. The ability to create a life and live that life for the period and for the sole purpose of achieving the goal of that performance. That is what makes you a good actor.
Wow. So what is the commonest mistake that most actors make?
The commonest mistake most actors make is assuming that they are actors.
I like that.
You know, a lot of people think that they can act, but they do not know how to act. And we see a lot of that these days. The truth is, Azu, acting is not acting. Because if you are acting, you cannot be truthful to the performance. You cannot be truthful, you cannot be expressive, you cannot be spontaneous. Acting is you. It is you. It is spontaneous. It is you. So when people are acting, it's almost like an emotional throw up, a vomit. So you see people, you know, you don't know why you are pained. When an actor cannot find the objective for an expression, that actor will be acting. You have to always find, why am I doing what? Can identify your why. If you can find your why, then your action and reaction will flow together.
Interesting. Now, is it really necessary, you know, for an actor to get any form of training first, you know, before going in front of the camera?
Yes, you must. Okay. I trained, like I said before, I started acting on radio. So it was more of, I was more of a voice actor than of a camera. Then I moved from there to stage. Stage is another thing altogether. Stage is as real as life itself. Camera acting is what I like to describe as head acting. Head acting because, you know, 60% of the work is not yours. It's the cameraman, the director, and the editor. They do the acting. They choose where to focus. They choose where to cut off. They can cut and take and cut and take several times. But on stage, you goof. So if you don't know it, you don't know it. You don't go and play around the stage because everybody sees you once and for all. So, but, you know, there are difference in expressions and everything between acting for stage and acting for camera. For instance, if I'm acting for camera, I am not as expressive. There's no exaggeration because the person next to me is just the same distance as the camera, right? So I speak as ordinarily as I would. But if I was doing the same thing for stage, then trust me that I'm going to have to project because it's important for the last person in the room. Even at this time, when we use microphones Technology has improved a lot of what we do on stage. Yet.
Now, between stage and home video, which do you prefer?
As Hilda, I prefer my stage.
Okay.
So I prefer, as Hilda, I prefer stage. I prefer stage because for me, stage is it. It gives you opportunity to keep training. Your rehearsal time is a training time for you. Your performance time is a show time and a training time for you. Whereas you need time to prepare because you can't afford any mistakes. There are no opportunities for cut and take it again. There are no opportunities.
I just see you is the second time. It's just you and the world. So I prefer stage because it gives you the confidence that you need as an actor. It gives you the growth, the speed of growth that you need. But, you know, camera sends you to a lot more people. So you can get to the end of the world. Whereas you're performing for a group, you know, a number at a time when you on stage. When you do camera, you don't know how far that work will go. The end of the world, people who were there when you were working and who were not there, everyone gets it. So they both have their game. But as a performer, I prefer my stage.
Thank you. Thank you. Now, acting has done a lot for you. What have you done for acting?
Hey, everything. Azu, I have done everything for acting. Everything.
I have trained and retrained. Don't forget, Azu, that I was the first person to start a reality program. Talent hunt program. And first to set up a training parlor for actors. And I'm still doing that even now. I have used acting as my tool of expression, even in activism and in governance. Because, you know, it's such a gift that enables you be who you want to be, when you want, how you want, and where you want. It gives you the audacity to be you. It gives you that audacity. Nobody can take that away from you. So what I have given back to acting is my entire life. There's no retirement now. And you know what? When you become a teacher of the craft, it means you're just going to keep doing this. It's for life. So when you are not before the audience, you are before your students. When you're not before your students, you are before a community of people who want to know about you, about career, about life, about coping, about a whole lot. So you're like a bit of everything. That's it. So yes, I have given my entire life for acting. Everything.
Interesting. Now, so what do you like most about being an actress?
What I like most about being an actor is the fact that I can explore me. I'm not embarrassed by my weaknesses. I'm not embarrassed by my vulnerabilities. I'm not embarrassed by my pains. You know, they are things that I have found useful in life because it's easy for me to go back to that, my pool of experience that other people probably will be chewing their fingers over. For me, it is a bank. It is a bank of knowledge. It's a bank of experience. It's a bank of emotions for me to go back to and tap from and tap into and draw from. So it's that part of my life as an actor that I enjoy the most, that I do not have to pretend for anyone to accept me. I'm not begging for acceptance. I'm already accepted, right? I'm not begging for acceptance. And you know, you get used to yes and no, and they don't mean anything for you as an actor, because for every one actor you see on stage, maybe 2,000 or 3,000 have been told no. And sometimes when you get the no, it's not because you don't know what to do or how to do it. It's that you probably do not fit into this particular role. So it you know, it kind of prepares you for life, because you don't get a yes all the time in life. As you check your journey to where you are, it hasn't been rosy. You remember when we all used to share bachangra? No. Once upon a time, we sat down in we shared our bachangra not. We will yab each other. We will quarrel. We will fight. We will come back. That's what this business does for you as a human being. You are happy all the time. It prepares you for life. The negative part of it prepares you for the hard knocks of life. The positive part of you prepares you for how to be extravagant, how to be a rich person. How to enjoy wealth, how to throw affluence around, and then the ugliest part of it, which is the fake part, gives you a pep. It will be very fake if you want to be a fake person, which of course a lot of people are gaining from that by being fake. But basically, it gives you the honor of being a human being. You are first a human being before anything else.
All right.